welcome to the farm. Happy 2015 to all of you. Here's what we have for you on the show this week. The return of IFRS. Amarjit Chopra, chairman of the National Advisory Committee on Accounting Standards, talks about the road ahead. Well, as the year turned, India made its second commitment to converging to IFRS. Now, the Ministry for Corporate Affairs has issued a circular making it mandatory for all companies with a net worth of 500 crore rupees or more and their holdings, subsidiary, joint venture and associate companies to apply Ind-AS, that's Indian Accounting Standards, starting FY17. Companies with a net worth of between 250 to up to 500 crore rupees and companies with listed debt or equity instruments, as well as all of their holding, joint venture, subsidiary or associate companies, must apply Indian Accounting Standards or Ind-AS starting FY18. To talk about India's second attempt at converging with IFRS, I have with me on the show Amarjit Chopra, chairman of the National Advisory Committee on Accounting Standards, or NACAS, as it's more commonly known. Mr. Chopra, thank you for your time. Let me start by asking you for what you believe will be the next steps as India makes this second effort to converge with IFRS.
Menkab, as the things stand today, the government has already announced the roadmap, and you have already said what that roadmap is. To me, more important issue would be, very frankly, that we also come up with, in consultation with Reserve Bank of India and Insurance Development Regulatory Authority, as to when they actually want these Ind-AS to be implemented. So far as immediately the next step is concerned, I can only say that the government has to go forward and notify whatever standards the NACAS has already handed over to the government for the purpose of notification. I personally feel the only hitch right now is that the translation in Hindi is taking place, and it's likely to take about another fortnight. And once that Hindi translation is over, after that the government will be able to notify these standards.
So there are going to be 39 Ind-AS or Indian Accounting Standards, sir, that will converge us to IFRS?
Yeah, 39 Ind-AS.
Okay, I'm going to try and understand from you what the impact of these new accounting standards will be on how India Inc. reports its financials, the key areas of impact, because obviously we can't do this, you know, on a company by company basis. You know, I've been looking at a Grant Thornton list. They've identified five areas of change that IFRS usually brings about. They've said accounting for financial instruments undergoes a comprehensive change. Group structures are likely to include more entities because of the new definition of control or new understanding of control. Use of fair value is going to be extensive and complex. Accounting for business acquisitions will become more challenging, and revenue recognition will witness certain high impact changes. In your assessment, sir, what are the areas that India Inc. will see the maximum change in?
You see, to me, the most important challenge will be so far as the Ind-AS 109 is concerned. That's the equivalent to IFRS 9, that's the financial instruments. See, earlier we had IAS 39, very frankly, but that is now virtually an outdated standard. I think this is one standard. Wherever the treasury transactions are high in the case of the various companies, I think it's going to impact them. There is no doubt about it. But I think that is one thing that needs to be done, and we definitely needed it.
Can you explain to us, you know, in a broad sense, what this new Ind-AS 109 will mean in terms of the changes to how companies report or account for financial instruments?
If you really look at it, today the preferential capital, as in all the corporates, is being treated as a part of the capital. But the moment the standard comes in, preferential capital being redeemable will be considered to be a liability, and it will be a debt basically. So accordingly, the entire thing undergoes a change. Whatever dividend even you declare with respect to the preferential capital will not be considered to be dividend. It will be considered to be an interest in respect thereof. So to my mind, this is a very significant challenge which is going to be there. Today we have a very simple standard which is called AS 13 to be applied with regard to valuation of investments. basically investment accounting. Now, that does not meet the requirements at all under any circumstances. So, when this IS 109 comes into play, I think it will deal with the complex issue of the derivatives, it will deal with the complex issues of the hedging also. So, I think lot many things are going to be there on I think on the plate, and in the bargain, I think the accounting will become far more transparent. But the maximum impact of this particular standard will be on the banks and insurance companies.
And as of now, sir, as of now, they are not part of the roadmap that's been announced by the MCA.
Yeah, truly. And the next standard, to my mind, which is going to really impact is the standard on the agriculture. You see, we have been an agricultural dominant economy all these years, but we didn't have any standard which was to deal with the agricultural operations at all. So we will have Ind-AS 41, which will be dealing with the agricultural operations. And when we deal with the agricultural operations, I'm also talking of the livestock, etc., to be dealt with. And the third standard, which is going to impact our financial statements, will be with regard to the revenue, very frankly. Because Ind-AS 115, with regard to the revenue, because now even the construction contracts, etc., will all be covered in one standard. Earlier, this particular part has been covered in different standards. We were dealing in AS 7 so far as the construction contracts were concerned. Revenue recognition was dealing with the sales and the sale of goods. And this was also dealing with the sale of services. This was dealing with the use of our resources by someone else. Now, all these things will fall under one standard. And to me, more important under this Ind-AS 115 is going to be the matter of that there are certain concepts which are going to be there, and that is going to impact us. So far, whatever credit period we have, that does not impact too much of our accounting, and everything is considered as a sale. But now, if you are going to give a longest, you can say a credit period, which is abnormal, probably that whatever you, the difference in the sale price as a consequence thereof could be considered to be a finance charge, and it will not be considered to be a revenue from the sale operations. So there could be different ways of looking at, and you look at it a little differently. If your product has a warranty, and that warranty is for a period of 5 years, generally you give a warranty of 1 year. This 4 year warranty, basically, the difference in the charge as a consequence thereof is not your sale operation. That will have to be considered a little bit differently. So the revenue part, when I look at it from the operations, when I look at the entire revenue from the sales, could be slightly different. So to my mind, in the periods to come, I'm not talking of the profitability figures right now. I think in some of the circumstances, the profitability figures may remain the same. In some circumstances, the profitability figures might undergo a change. But the depiction from which heads this income is coming will definitely undergo a change in the periods to come.
I do want to ask you, sir, what you consider will be the top challenges that India Inc. faces as it converges to Ind-AS or converges to IFRS. You know, I think, over 660 listed companies in this country have a net worth of 500 crore rupees or more. Even if I were to take banking, NBFC and insurance companies out of that list, we do have a sizable list of companies that will need to adopt Ind-AS in a very short period from now. What do you expect will be the challenges as India Inc. goes about this process?
I will say, to my mind, there are three or four major challenges. Number one challenge is the tax system in the country, basically. You see, if you remember, Manika, in the last attempt that we had in 10-11 to make it effective 1/4/2011, one of the biggest issues was with regard to the tax structure of the country. There are certain countries where the tax is applied on consolidated financial statements. In our case, this is applied on the standalone financial statements. And the moment you talk of the fair valuation, one of the fears in the mind of the industry has been that when you fair value something, if you have a gain, the assessing officer is going to tax it, and when there is going to be a fair value loss, probably the assessing officer is going to say, it is not the incurred loss as at the present moment, so I'm going to disallow this particular part. Rather than mitigating this particular hardship, I think the CBDT has been coming up with the idea of having tax computation standards. One of the very basic purposes of introducing the IFRS equivalent standards in the country was that the cost of duplication of the effort should be minimized. Now, if you are going to have tax computation standards which are based upon the cost concept, in that particular case, what is going to happen? To some extent, there has to be a duplication of the records. There is no doubt about it. And which will mean that there is some kind of a cost to be incurred in maintenance of that record. Again, I'm coming over to certain indirect tax challenges also. Now, as I said to begin with, when I was talking about the revenue recognition, at that particular point of time when I talked of Ind-AS 115, if you say that certain sale component is in the nature of the finance charge, and I'm going to show it as a finance charge, will the excise people agree to that? Excise people are still going to say, no, no, it's a part of my sale price. So that's another change in the indirect taxes. The second challenge to my mind will be with regard to the IT systems. And this IT systems will have to undergo a change. And this will involve some kind of a cost. There is no doubt about it. I think some of the bigger industries which have already raised money from abroad are seized of the matter. They have already implemented those systems. But this cost, when as and when it comes to the banks and insurance companies, I think it will have a huge amount. That's the way I look at it.
Okay.
But the systemic changes will have to be brought in so far as this particular issue is concerned. Another challenge which to my mind will be there are certain carve-outs that we are going to bring. And those carve-outs will be absolutely minimal, but keeping in view the requirement of the Indian industry and certain other factors where probably some of the options may not be misused by anyone. So we have opted for those minimal carve-outs.
So what are those carve-outs, if you could share with us, please?
You see, one of the carve-outs is that if you look at Ind AS 1 itself, internationally, when you define a current liability, what you say is that if you have taken a loan, if you have borrowed certain amounts from, say, you have taken some loan from a bank, and there were various covenants, and if you breach any of the covenants, and if the lender has got a right to recall the loan, irrespective of the fact whether they have recalled the loan or not, in that particular case, it will be considered to be a current liability. But what we have said is that if we do this in Indian circumstances, you really ask me, what kind of current liabilities people will have to show in the books of accounts, you know it, and where the current ratios will go, I don't know. So what we have said is that wherever there are material breaches of the covenants, but that irregularity has been set right before the adoption of the accounts, in that case, it may not be treated as a current liability. And as a consequence of that, we will have to really even have a carve-out in the Ind AS 10 also, which deals with the events after the reporting date. So we will have certain carve-outs. Now, this carve-out is in the favor of the industry, if you really ask me.
Yes.
Then otherwise, what in the case of the leases, what was going to happen is that if any agreement contained a clause of escalation, it said that you consider all those escalations and then treat it as based upon the straight line, just write off those escalations also along with the lease rentals. What we have said is that if the escalation is linked with the inflation, in that case you need not straight line it. So to that extent, there will be a relief for the Indian corporates for that matter. And certain options we have done away with, very frankly, like in investment property, the option was that you could fair value it and still take it to the revenue account. We said nothing doing. If you allow this option, in that case people will take something to the revenue, declare the dividend, distribute the dividend out of earned income, which is not realized so far. So we have tried to avoid those kind of situations.
Okay. So I do want to ask you for a clarification. These Indian accounting standards or Ind-AS and this roadmap to IFRS, will it apply to standalone financial accounts or consolidated accounts, sir?
To us, it is very clear that it is going to apply to both. You see, one of the demands of the industry was that you apply it only on the consolidated financial statements.
Right.
But then both the accounting standard board, the institute and the NACAS were of the opinion that the moment you make it only based upon the consolidated, you apply it only to the consolidated, the confusion is going to be far more than what it is today. Because from standalone converting it, consolidating and then converting it to the IFRS will not serve the purpose. In whichever country it is happening, there probably the taxation structure is different, and there the taxation structure is on the consolidated financial statements. In India, the taxation structure is based upon the standalone financial statements, so accordingly we must apply to the standalone financial statements and then move on to the consolidated, and both these statements must comply with the Ind-AS requirements.
Okay, my final question then, sir, has to do not with IFRS or Ind-AS, but some of the other changes that NACAS is currently attending to, which is changes to Indian GAAP to bring them closer to where Ind-AS is currently or will be in a few weeks from now. If you could very briefly outline to us what some of those key changes will be.
You see, I can only tell you that one of the changes which will be coming by way of Ind-AS even will be componentization approach in the property, plant and equipment, which is not there. Today, if you have a machinery, you have a machinery in hand. But if there is a significant component thereof, you don't have the values thereof and you don't depreciate those separately. Now, effective, once Ind-AS is implemented, it's going to be there. But if you look at the Schedule 3 today and Schedule 2 today of the company, that Schedule 2 has already required this approach to be followed. But then the Institute went to the Ministry of Corporate Affairs and the chambers also went to the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and they have agreed that this componentization approach will be effective only 1/4/2014 or 2015. Now, we will definitely have to bring our AS10 today, property, plant and equipment, in line therewith. Today, we don't have the componentization approach, so that's what we are going to have.
Okay.
Similarly, the revenue recognition will have to undergo a change, and definitely to some extent. And we'll have to see how do we bring the real estate transactions under which head these are going to be taxed, and how do we deal with the construction contracts if you are going to implement 115 later on. So to my mind, there are certain standards which have to be brought in line with. And today, whatever AS1 today we have, that is with regard to the disclosure of the accounting policies, that's too primitive. I think we'll have to bring it in line with the Ind-AS one for that matter, presentation of financial statements. So I think this is what is going to happen.
All right, Mr. Chopra, I suspect that this is the first of many conversations that we will have with you through the course of 2015. Our next date with you is once the Ind-AS are notified by the ministry, and then we'll dive in deep on the impact on financial reporting by India Inc. Thank you for your time today, and thank you very much for watching. But before I go, a hat tip to Chris Parsons. Chris Parsons heads the India practice of UK's leading law firm, Herbert Smith. As he finishes 30 years at his firm, he's celebrating it by walking for charity. Chris has raised $280,000 in the last 6 months and is now walking for more.
I've been coming to India now for about 10 years, and I was very keen to do something charitable coming here to India. And so 2 years ago, I decided to walk for the Lumba Foundation that supports widows and their children through my friendship with Raj Lumba. And this year marks my 30 years at my firm. And so I decided to round that up, 30 years, 30 marathons, 30 days. And I thought it would be wonderful to walk down the west coast of India from Mumbai, starting at the Gateway of India, down through Goa, Mangalore, and then across the Western Ghats through Mysore, arriving in Bangalore, I hope, on the 8th of February.